Hello, hello, hello. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Everyone know what day it is today?
Friday.
Happy Friday. I'm scared. So, unlike Richard, I am doing this for real internet points. Yes, I am scared. I don't actually have any puns for this talk, so I don't know what to do. So I figured instead of me just talking, we would watch Mad Max for the next 40 minutes. I don't know. Well, maybe that's not so good since I'm supposed to be speaking here. Anyway, I'm not going to talk about performance at all. Which is what I normally talk about, and I was telling my wife I'm extremely nervous about this talk because it's probably the least technical talk I've given in quite a while. And she said, well, to calm yourself down, you should add some graphs or metaprogramming or something to it. So I just added a graph here, just to calm me down. Because I'm talking, this is not a technical talk, really. And I actually didn't know that the hashtag was going to be hashtag. I just wanted to encourage everyone to tweet about my talk with hashtag. I really actually didn't know that. And I had the slide in here before then. Anyway, so thank you for having me. I'm really excited to be here. Thank you to the conference organizers. This is a picture of me with parents at the airport. It was really amazing. He picked me up in this outfit. He actually had a sign. It's cut off here at the bottom. I don't have it on this photo, but he had a sign for me, which I thought was great. Although it said Aaron Patterson on it, when I think it should have said tender love. Imagine him waiting at the airport. Anyway, I want to say thanks to ThoughtPod a lot. I couldn't be here without them. As Richard said, I work for Red Hat. So please buy some stuff from Red Hat. Maybe. I'm on the Manage IQ team there, which we're doing stuff with managing the cloud. So if you have a cloud that you need to manage, manage it. So I am assistant pharmacist Tenderlove. I actually have, you may not be able to see it there, but I have Tenderlove embroidered here on my outfit. You can come up and see it later. I'm Tenderlove on the internet. I'm also on the Ruby core team and the Rails core team. And I'm really excited to be here, but I was thinking about the name, Keep Ruby Weird, and I started to think like, wow, this sounds exciting, Keep Ruby Weird, but why was I invited? I mean, I'm not weird. why am I here? And then I realized this. That's why I was invited. Okay. Alright. Now we know. So anyway, I am wearing a wig today so that you all would recognize me. Take photos with it later. I have two cats. This is Gorbachev Puff Puff Thunderhorse. He's the more famous of my cats. This is my other cat, Choo Choo. Her full name is SeaTac Airport YouTube Facebook Hotel. Just call her Choo Choo though. She's more interested in programming. This is her in her natural habitat on top of my laptop. I sit next to the kitchen. I went into the kitchen, get a drink. Come back out, and there's a cat right on my laptop, and I look at it, and I'm like, what are you doing? And the cat's just like, what? This is where I sit. Anyway, so she also has a red hat. Dress her up. I like dressing up the cats. This is what she's going to be for Halloween. Also, Gorbachev, we dressed him up too. He's a wrestler. This is a wrestling album. Anyway, so book sales time. So it's time for me to start selling my books, right? Because that's like trying to figure out what I'm going to do with my career. I figure, well, I'm going to start selling books. So I One thing you may or may not know about me is that I like to cure meats at home. And so the way that you do this, is the way that you cure meats, like overall process is basically you put a bunch of meat into some casings and you hang it in a fridge for a while, and then it, after a while, it turns into meat, into cured meat, or it rots if you do it wrong. So don't do it wrong. Just do it right, and you'll be fine. Anyway, you have to control the humidity inside of these refrigerators, and the humidity has to be pretty high, about 70% humidity, 70 to 80% humidity. And most fridges aren't built to maintain that, so a lot of water will condense and then drip out the back of the fridge. And a lot more water drips, like this happens normally inside of everybody's refrigerators, it's just not very much water will drip out the back. But since I have to actually pump humidity into this fridge, a lot of water drips out the back, so I needed to have a place to run it, and I ran it to this, like I stuck a tube into the back of the fridge, and I ran it out into this tray that collects all the water, right? And I mean, it collects maybe like, probably has like a gallon of water in it at a time, right? And I had it sitting out there, and it was uncovered, and my cats were drinking it. And my wife says, like, she's like, you can't, don't let the cats drink that. They're not allowed to be drinking that water. And I'm like, who cares? That like, it condensed. It's got to be, like, super pure, right? Like, it's going to be fine. It condensed on the back, comes out the back. It's got to be pure water. She's like, no, that's salami water. And I'm like, no, it's fine. It's probably, like, super pure. Don't worry about it. And she's like, no, it's that she insisted it was salami water. So I was like, you know what? Fine. I'm going to taste this sausage water. So I got a spoon, dipped it in. Took a taste of it, and I was like, oh, yeah, that is sausage water. That is sausage water. So we had to cover that up. But anyway, so this is the book I'm working on. So this is going to be in stores in 2015, so please, like, you know, buy my book. Please. So my talk title is Keep Ruby Weird. I kept thinking about the title of this conference and like, oh, Ruby's weirdness and stuff. And I actually really like the title of this. I like the title of this conference. So I kept thinking about how do we keep Ruby weird. So I want to talk about that a bit. That's going to be most of the talk here. I'm going to talk about mistakes in public speaking, then I'm going to talk about is Ruby weird, then I'm going to talk about homeopathic code optimizations, and then I'm going to talk about keeping Ruby weird. I said I wasn't going to talk about performance, but I will a little bit, just a very tiny bit in the homeopathic code optimizations. But first I want to talk about things that I've been thinking about. So like, I think Ruby is amazing. Ruby is an amazing language. I love Ruby. We've made so much progress recently. I don't know if you've noticed this, but the garbage collector is getting better. Ruby 2.2 is going to have we have a generational garbage collector in 2.1, but 2.2, the generational garbage collector, is going to be getting even better. 10 years ago, we wouldn't have imagined having a garbage collector like this. 10 years ago, our garbage collector was just a normal stop the world mark and sweep garbage collector. Nobody thought, oh, we're going to have an actual generational garbage collector, and today we do. I think it's amazing. The language is improving, and we can see it coming along and getting better. But the thing is, like, people are still complaining about the language. People say, oh, Ruby's slow, blah, blah, blah. They're complaining about it all the time. And I don't really like this. So what I was thinking about doing is I want to start a new language. I want to implement a brand new language, and I'm going to call this language Poolang. This is a language. It is specifically engineered to be the worst language ever. And the reason I want to do this is so that whenever anybody complains about a particular language, whether it's Ruby or Python or PHP, you can say like, well, you know, if you think Ruby is bad, like, have you seen Poolang? I think it's terrible. That's the worst language ever. So that's what I want to strive for, is build the worst language possible. And I think like it'd be really good for making puns too, because you could say like, in Poolang, everything is code smell. It's my favorite one. I mean, there's a lot of potential in this language for bad stuff. So I was thinking what we'll do is We'll implement it in Excel. Because I think you can do that. I think you can. So, you know, Poolang, the worst language ever. We actually have a website now. You can go to it. It's poolang.org. You can go to this website. But it has some known issues. So this is what it looks like in Safari. This is what it looks like in Chrome. It just doesn't work on Windows. I don't care. I mean, it's called Poolang. Actually, we had some. I put this website up. I have a project on GitHub. It's public. You can go to my GitHub and find, you know, mess with the website. And like the first ticket that somebody files is like, it doesn't work in Windows. Are you freaking kidding me? Why do you care? That is the internet, people. It's the internet. Like, this is what happens. Anyway, so seriously, I want to make this. I actually want to make this. We should seriously make this language. But I don't think we should do it in Excel. I think we should do it in PostScript. We should. No, seriously. So look at this. Like, I don't know if any of you have ever actually written PostScript straight, but PostScript is a stack-based language. Like, it's just a stack. So this is an example of using PostScript, well, GhostScript. Like, you just say, we actually have a stack here, so we say 10, you hit enter with that, that puts 10 on the stack. And then you say 5, and you hit enter, and that puts 5 on the stack, and then you say add, and it adds those two together and puts the result back on the stack. So we have this stack-based programming language. And if you look at Ruby, Ruby's virtual machine is also a stack-based virtual machine. This is the instruction sequences for Ruby. So we say like put object 5, that puts a 5 on the stack, put object 10, that puts a 10 on the stack, and then we add, and then 15 is put back on the stack. So the Ruby VM is stack-based, and the PostScript is also stack-based. Therefore, the Ruby VM should equal the PostScript VM, right? Right? We can do this. We can do this. Though this might be a mistake. It might be a mistake. But I think mistakes are just fine. I think it's fine. Even if we did implement this thing, it would be fine because it would be fun, like something fun to learn. Like we'd be able to learn about stack-based programming languages and converting Ruby into a stack and actually how the virtual machine works under the hood. So anyway, now on to the real subject. I want to talk about some mistakes in public speaking, like mistakes that I've made. The point of this section here is basically to tell you about like how I do public speaking, how I've made mistakes with public speaking, how you can be a better speaker, and etc. Hopefully this will help out all of the other speakers here today. And for those of you who want to speak but maybe haven't done it yet, so hopefully you can get some pro tips from me here. And I want to tell you about how I practice speaking, and I actually practice a lot. I practice very, very frequently. And I mostly practice with my parents and my family and my wife. I actually call my parents all the time and tell them like about exactly what I do. I tell them that I'm a programmer, and you know, I tell them what I do all day and explain all the different stuff. Like I even explain to them weird things like, you know, Rails performance issues, things like that. I explain all this stuff to them. And the thing is, like, both of my parents are engineers. My mom's an electrical engineer. My dad's a mining engineer. Neither of them know, like, they don't know programming very well, but they're both, like, capable people. They're both, you know, capable, intelligent people. So it's not a big deal to explain to them, like, all this stuff. It's just that, you know, they might not have heard about these particular things, right? Like, if you think about it, or the way I think about it, is that any capable person can understand what I do, or can do what I do, it's just they don't have any experience doing it yet. So the way I approach it is, I assume that people are capable. I assume anybody can do what I do, it's just that maybe they don't have the same experiences that I do. So what I try to do is say, like, okay, well, they haven't heard about Ruby programming. Let's try to explain how this is. Like, anybody can understand it. It's just that they haven't heard about it yet, right? So I try to think about it from their perspective. Think about like their experiences and well, my experiences, and know that they just haven't had the same experience as I have. And if they did, they could do what I do. So I try to explain it to them from that perspective, and I think that helps with my explanations a lot. So I can, if I can explain it to my parents, I can explain it to anybody, and I know that anybody can do what I do, so I should be able to explain to everyone. So if I understand their perspective, it makes it easier to explain to other people. So now, I want to talk about some actual mistakes. I said there wouldn't be any puns, maybe there are. Okay, so I'm going to talk about a few different mistakes that I've made in public speaking, and hopefully you will not make those mistakes, too. And this is the first one. You may have heard about this one before, but if you haven't, I will tell you about it. I was going to give a talk at RailsConf, a keynote at RailsConf, in front of about 2,000 people, and every time I give a talk, I'm extremely nervous. I'm very, very nervous. And one of the things that I do before I give a talk, and this might be a little bit private, but I go to the bathroom. I always go to the bathroom first. And the reason I do that is because, like, I don't want to be up on stage and all of a sudden be like, I gotta go to the bathroom. That wouldn't be very good, you know, that wouldn't be very good for the talk that you're giving. So, you know, I'm there, I'm gonna give this talk, I'm insanely nervous, I can't, like, I'm like, all right, well, I gotta go do my thing. I go to the bathroom, I go in the bathroom, I'm like, okay, all I see is stalls, it's fine, I gotta use a stall, okay, I'll go use it. And like, let me tell you something about men's bathrooms, especially in large airports, is you go in and maybe you only ever see stalls because the urinals are somewhere else, right? So I thought everything was normal, go do my business. I leave the stall, I come out, and I see a cleaning person in the bathroom, and I'm like, oh, cleaning person's a woman. That's fine. I don't mind. I mean, I'm an adult. It's okay there's a woman in the bathroom. And then I look over, and I see somebody washing her hands. And I'm like, oh, no. And the cleaning lady says to me, she just points at me, and she's like, get out of here! And I'm like, oh my god, what have I done? And I think, like, immediately, I'm like, do I wash my hands? So I just, like, I run out. I wash my hands in the correct bathroom, but I ran out. So this is the very first mistake that I made. Like, don't, like, pay attention to where you're going to the bathroom before you give a talk. Like, I recommend you go to the bathroom first, just please pay attention to where you're going. Anyway, this is one of my first mistakes. Second one I want to talk about is my tender parents. So I mentioned earlier that, you know, I tell my parents what I do. You know, I tell them all about the programming stuff that I do and all the problems I'm solving and all this stuff. But there's one thing about my technical career that I have never told them, and that is that everybody knows me by the name Tenderlove. I have omitted this fact from our relationship. So, I was invited to give, I grew up in Salt Lake City, I was invited to give a talk in Salt Lake City. I live in Seattle. I used to work with a conference organizer, and he kept inviting me year after year. He's like, please come give a talk at our conference. And I always say, no, I'm not going back to Utah. Mainly because, like, I'm not much against Utah, since I grew up there, and, you know, I go home for Christmas or Thanksgiving every year, and that's enough for a year. Once a year is fine. But he was like, please come give a talk, and I was like, you know what, I tell my parents what I do, I'd really like them to actually see me give a talk. So I said to the organizer, I was like, okay, yes, I will come give a talk at your conference, but under one condition, and that is that you have two tickets, I need two extra tickets for my parents. And of course the organizer's like, absolutely, no problem. So I'm like, okay, great. Go to the conference, meet the organizer, you know, my parents are there, we all meet the organizer, and he's like, oh, hey, we have three seats reserved for you down at the front, and like, this is right before my talk. I'm like, okay, great. We all go in, go down to the front, and there's three seats reserved. There's a sign on each of the seats. And the first one says Tender Love. The next one says Tender Mom. The next one says Tender Dad. And I'm just like, oh. No. Not now. So I was like, all right. I'm like, okay. Before I give a talk, I have to give a talk real quick. Everybody knows me by this name. The name is Tenderlove. Everybody knows me by this. Everyone here knows me by this name. People will ask you about that. Just don't worry about it. Just be cool, please. So I gave a talk. You know, I gave a talk and it was fine. And they haven't asked me about it since then, which I think is good. Anyway, so I guess I'm not sure exactly what this mistake was, but I probably should have told them that beforehand. I shouldn't have omitted this name for so long, but I did, and I paid the price. So final mistake. I want to talk about. So I was going to a conference, and I'm not going to tell you what conference this was. I was going to a conference, and my wife was coming along with me, and she packed so much stuff. I don't even know why. Like, books, like books on design, tons of books and stuff. What, are you going to set up a library there? What are you doing? We're only going to be there for like 2 days. You're not going to read this? Just don't. Anyway, so I'm giving her a hard time about how much stuff she's packing. And I'm like, yeah, I mean, check out my bag. It's super light. This is fine. Like, why, you know, why can't you pack this lightly? Anyway, so I'm giving her a hard time about this. And we get to the conference. Everything's fine. I arrived the day before. I was the first talk in the morning. And we go to bed, get up in the morning, go to take a shower. Open up my clothes, time to get dressed. I am missing underwear. Completely gone. None in the bag. And I was like, oh, this is why my bag is so light. I see. Wow. So I gave a talk without wearing any underwear. And I normally, like, one of the things that they tell you is you're supposed to imagine everybody else in your underwear, like, to make yourself feel more, you know, feel more calm on stage. And like I was like experiencing this in reverse and opposite, like, on stage without any underwear. I don't recommend this. Like, please don't do this. It's not, like, make sure you pack everything. So this was a huge mistake on my part. Make sure you pack everything. There was actually a sports store nearby. My wife went out and bought some underwear for me. Unfortunately, it was like, you know, she had it for me right after I was done. I was like, oh, thank you. I appreciate that. And she's like, oh, so I packed too much stuff. I'm like, why now? Anyway, so mistakes are just fine. Like, I made all these mistakes, public speaking, and I'm still alive. Like, it's okay. So you can come up and give a talk, make a mistake, it'll be fine, you'll improve. I know from now on, like, I'm not going to hide that my name is Tenderlove for my parents. I will pay attention to the bathrooms that I attend, bathroom conferences I attend. I will also pay attention to making sure that I pack everything. But I've learned from all these mistakes. Recently I lost a passport. I can tell you about that later if that is horrible. Anyway, so I was thinking to myself, this conference, you know, keep Ruby weird. That means Ruby is already weird, right? Like, if we're keeping it that way. And I was thinking to myself, is Ruby weird? I'm not sure. Is it weird? Is it weird or not? So I started looking at the language. I was like, what does this mean? What does this mean by weird? So I started thinking about the language. I'm like, you know, well, okay, let's compare this to other languages. So I started looking at other languages. This is a language called Anti. This prints out "Hello World." This is the code here, so you can run that. Prints out "Hello World." That's great. So Ruby doesn't seem too weird compared to that. Here's another language called Piet or Pyte. I'm not sure how to pronounce it. This prints out the name of the language, but it's interpreted. So the interpreter reads this image and gets its instructions based on the image. So this is a pretty weird language. And of course, like, I have to mention this one. Everybody knows this one. This is also a programming language here, Hello World example. Another one of my favorites is Whitespace. Whitespace language. This is my favorite one. This is a Hello World program. Or is it? So if you look at Ruby, here's a program in Ruby, and I look at this, and I was like, I don't think Ruby is weird. It's not a very weird language. Ruby is pretty nice. And then I started thinking about other languages that I programmed in, like, for example, Java. Here's a hello world in Java. Yeah, I know, right? And then C++. Ah. I mean, this is not super exciting either. And what I think is interesting about this is if we look at, I try to put this on a scale, it's like scale of weirdness. And, Ruby's here in the middle, and like our perspective is from, if we look at Ruby, we look at this through Ruby eyes, and we say like, oh man, those languages are weird. And put white space in there, but, well, it's there. It's just white So, those languages are weird, but if you think about Ruby from the perspective of, these languages, I used to program Java every day, and when I was used to that programming language, or when I was used to those languages, looking at Ruby, Ruby was weird. It was weird, coming from that perspective, right? So, it depends on how you look at it. It really depends on your perspective. Where are you coming from? Where are you coming from? Comparing something to where you are today. So, coming at it from, say, a Java or a C++ person, maybe this language is weird. But, all those people who write white space for their day jobs, they don't think Ruby is weird at all. Tap, tap, space, only need two keys. Someone should make a white space keyboard. That would be amazing. What language was? I can't remember the language. What was the language that had a special keyboard? There was one. APL. Thank you. Yes. We should do that before white space. That'd be amazing. So then I was thinking, Ruby's not very weird. I don't think the language is weird. But what about the people? So let's think about the people. I was thinking about my past experiences as a programmer. And when I started programming, this may be a surprise to you, but when I started programming, I was not a very good programmer. I suspect many people, when they start programming, are not very good programmers. So the first language that I was ever paid to do was Perl. I was a Perl programmer. I liked doing Perl a lot. But the community was kind of strange. I was on the Perl 5 quarters list. I would mail there. People were not super nice to me there. I was a noob. And it was not exactly that great to be in, although there was actually one person in the Perl community that I really, really looked up to, Damien Conway. He's one of my favorite Perl people. I take a lot of inspiration from him. But this community, I would not say it was very weird at all. It was just, a group of people that were on mailing lists and, nothing super exciting about it. And then after I was a Perl programmer for maybe, 4 years or so, and then I became a Java programmer. I was a Java programmer. Don't tell anybody this secret of mine. I don't think I've told my parents this either. Just kidding, I wasn't. I told them that. They knew that. And so I was thinking about, what about the Java community? What Java community? So, when I was a Java programmer, we're laughing about it now, but really there wasn't anything. I wasn't part of any mailing lists. As a Java programmer, where would you go for community? What would you do? You go to Java 1? I can't afford that. I can't afford Java 1. Back then, this is over 10 years ago when I was a Java programmer. Back then, there wasn't really much, there wasn't much of a community. This community thing wasn't really a thing, I don't think. So I was thinking about this, and I also thought about the Python community. I was never a Python programmer. But one thing, recently, maybe, I don't remember how long ago, one of the Django core team members said to me, Aaron, you should give a talk at PyCon. And I was like, me, give a talk at PyCon? And he was like, yeah, you should give a talk at PyCon about, compare and contrast Rails and Django. You could talk about why Rails is better than Django. And I was like, well, I don't actually know Django at all. So it seems like a bad move for me to get up in front of a bunch of people and tell them why Rails is better. But I asked him, I was like, you know, PyCon, obviously many people must bring pies to this conference, right? Like, this seems like a thing. And he was like, no, nobody's ever done that before. I'm like, are you freaking kidding me? PyCon? How could you not? That's amazing. And I thought it was a strange interaction that, I mean, doing something like that would be pretty common, I think, at a Ruby conference, but maybe not so much in other communities. Anyway, so after being a Java programmer for a while, it was extremely depressing. I became a Ruby programmer. It was less depressing. But the weird thing was, is when I became a Ruby programmer, like, at the time I was learning Ruby, and back then nobody was paid to do Ruby. Everybody was doing it as a hobby. Everybody was doing this just as, like, their fun language. And what I really, really liked about the Ruby community is that it valued creativity very highly. I mean, back then, like, I started doing Ruby, and then a little while after I started doing that, Y came out with this poignant guide, and I was like, wow, this is amazing. I've never seen this type of stuff with other programming languages. This community really values creativity. The other thing that really struck a chord with me is how friendly people were on mailing lists and stuff, and mailing lists, IRCs, or IRC, like, I could ask stupid questions and it was fine. Nobody cared. They would help me out. And I think this is really important because it turns out, I will tell you this from personal experience, it turns out that helping people is fun. It's actually something fun to do. And it's fun because once you help people, those helped people help other people, and you can see it grow. Like, it turns out if we help each other and the community gets better, it's actually a more fun place to be, interestingly. So what I really liked about this community, again, was that mistakes were just fine. It was fine for me to make mistakes, it was fine for me to screw up, people would help me out, you know, they would tell me the right way to do something, tell me the better way or the good, correct way to do something. So that's one thing I really liked about this community. So again, I was thinking about this from community weirdness perspective, like, maybe, you know, well, Java didn't really have communities per se, but again, it's about perspective, right? It depends on the community that you're part of. It's all about the perspective, where you're coming from. The, you know, obviously the white space community thinks that we are not a very weird community, right? You are all on the white space mailing list, right? It's hard to read mail on there. Anyway, what I really liked is that we value creativity so much. It made me very happy to be here. So now I want to talk about homeopathic code optimizations. This is a new technique that I've been pioneering. We all know about the facts of homeopathy and how they help people, right? We all know about these facts. So for those of you that don't know about it, I'm going to explain what it is so that you can know too. And what is homeopathy? It's about diluting stuff. It's about diluting stuff. So it's like very, very small. Okay? So as any good researcher does, I went to the Wikipedia page, and it was, like, way too long. So what I decided to do instead was, because homeopathy is about diluting stuff, I figured out, well, the best way we can do this, we'll take this, highlight it. If you right-click and you go to services, there's this thing there, summarize. You do that. And then I just dragged that down into a one-liner, and I was like, oh, yeah, there we go. I'm not sure if this is dilution or compression, but I'll call it dilution. So this is dilution, right? And so the important part to take away from this is we dilute stuff, and also we dilute it in water. And water apparently has memory. It's pretty amazing. I didn't know this. Water has memory, and water will remember the substances it's mixed into. I love Wikipedia's editing. Kills me. I love quotes like that. Anyway, so water has memory. And I was thinking to myself, you know what? If water can have memories, can white space have memories? Can white space have memories too? And I thought for sure, yes, absolutely white space can have memories. The answer is yes. So, what I would like to do for you today is, I'm not sure until when I'm going, but I want to do a demo. I'm going to do a demo. So I wrote a homeopathic code optimizer, and I want to demo it for you today. So we're going to do that. We're going to do that now. Command tab. Come on. Okay. So let me shut off. Display mirroring, or turn on display mirroring here. Okay, so this is our code. It's Fibonacci sequence, because that's what I always test things with. It's the best way to get, the Fibonacci sequence is the best way to get the performance of any virtual machine, measure the performance. It is the perfect benchmark. all right, so anyway, here we all saw, is that big enough?
It's
big enough.
Yeah.
Is it big enough? Okay, everyone can read that, cool. So here we have terminal 2, so we'll say like, I have a script called dilute. Is this, everyone can read this too? We good?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. And then we have fib, so fib is there, cool, so we can run fib, and it'll give us the value back. Alright, so that's the value of the Fibonacci sequence. So I can take and run the dilute program on the Fibonacci sequence. There's the diluted version. You can see some of the characters are missing, right? Now the white space and the virtual machine together, they remember the missing characters. They remember it. Now this is running at a 10% dilution, right? And you'll remember from the slides, the maximum, what we want to do is, from the summary, you want to dilute it by 6 times. But here, let me show you this. We'll pipe it to Ruby. Like, it still runs. gives us the value. So we know like the VM and the white space together, they remember these values. We can even pipe them together, so we'll say like, all right, pipe, dilute. So it dilutes it even more. Each character has a 10% chance of going away. So that's still runnable. We can still pipe that to Ruby and run it. So yeah, we're still calculating the Fibonacci sequence there. So we'll do it like, we can do it like, okay, let's do it 6 times. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is the optimum one. This is the optimum dilution rate there. So that's what it looks like. And we can still, okay, is it still runnable? Yeah, okay. So we can still run it. Thank you. They remember, and just to show you that I'm not, like, I want to prove I'm not messing with you at all here. This is true homeopathy. There's no trick involved here, okay? This is just the science. The science of homeopathy. So I'll change it up here. Let's change it up just to prove it's real. So we'll say, like, self.fib, alright? And we can say, it's fib.fib. I'll fix the indentation so we can all read it. Oops, it's a dot there. And let's do like 35. I don't know, doesn't matter. So we can dilute that. We'll dilute it. So it's still, you know, I changed that. So we got, you can see the class there, and of course the white space remembers as a class, and we just pipe that to Ruby, and we're still, this might take a little longer. All right, so we're still calculating the Fibonacci sequence. So it works. And it's amazing, right? Okay. Oh, thank you. That was a demonstration. Shut off display mirroring, and back to that. And I prepared a video in case it didn't work. Anyway, so how does this work? Like, how are we doing this? Well, as I was mentioning earlier, the way that this program works is that the virtual machine actually remembers the code. It remembers it. So what we have there is not white space, it's memory. That's what we actually have. That's what we're actually producing here. What's interesting too about this language is that, or about doing homeopathic code optimizations, is that it actually, like, if you run it enough, it actually goes into the white space language. Right? So it turns into white space language, and I'm not going to do it, like, I'll just run the video here. So if we run it, cut that out there, and if we run it enough, I don't remember. Okay, so I added a dilution ratio, so you can say D50C. I don't know if any of you know about homeopathy, but 50C is like, that's the units. Sure, what unit that is. We can do like 100C, and we pipe it through it, it's all white, so that's a, right, it still runs. It still works. So the benefits of this, the benefits of homeopathic homeopathy is it's faster. And we know this. So we know this. The reason we know this is it's because of this axiom. No code is faster than no code. So if the code is going away, then it's got to be faster. It's not there anymore. This is, we know this. So the more diluted it is, the faster it gets. So I want to share. I want to share some benchmarks with you. So let's, you know, I'll just run the video. So just time it, simple time, we're on Ruby, on our normal Fibonacci sequence, and then we'll do the same thing with the diluted version. Pipe that to Ruby. Well, okay, write it out to a file, and then run the file, because we don't want to get the dilution processing time, right? Okay, maybe it wasn't faster that time. It's usually faster. Trust me. Just trust me. So the other benefits are it's more maintainable, obviously. I mean, there's no code to maintain, right? Less is more. Less is more. Anyway, with that out of the way, I wanna finish it off here quickly. Keeping Ruby weird. So I really want, like, I'm really happy to be at this conference. The name Keep Ruby Weird means so much to me. Like, I love doing weird stuff with the language. I love doing, you know, different creative things or making mistakes. And I want to make sure that in our community mistakes are okay, but that we can rely on the community to help us out to fix these mistakes anytime we do mess up. Or when we do something creative, everybody along laughs about it, or, you know, we all participate in this together. So I think one problem that we have is, I want to talk about one problem that we have and then how we can deal with this. I was talking about Ruby of the past when I started to be a Ruby programmer. Back then, nobody was paid to do Ruby, and we were trying to help each other out and actually get paid to do this. We wanted to bring more people in. But today, the fact is, Ruby is a popular language. Many people use it. Many people are paid to do Ruby, right? People are paid to do Ruby today, and some people are just here for the money. It's just a job. I mean, I'm sure you work with people like this. I do, for sure. They just program Ruby. It's their job. And what's even more interesting is that our community is so big now that there are people who don't actually want to program Ruby during their day job. They come to work, and they're like, oh, man, I don't want to program Ruby. I don't want to do it. I want to do something else, right? They want to program in some other language. And it's just that our community has gotten that big. The thing is, though, I think that the weird is still here. We still have this weird. We still have these attributes about our community. But I'm afraid that it could get diluted, as in our earlier example. So what I really want us to do, what I really think that we need to do in order to keep this feeling of a weird community is we need to rally around the positive voices that we have in our community. And you're going to be seeing a lot of those today. A lot of the other speakers that are coming after me. We need to rally around these people. So, in closing, maybe Ruby is weird, but I don't want to change that. I want to change everybody else. I want to make everybody else weird. So, that is my talk. Thank you very much.